So my name is Brandon Dimcheff. I usually look like that on the internet. I work for Olark, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our migration from sort of Puppet-managed legacy infrastructure to Kubernetes. We're not done with this yet, but we've already learned some important lessons, I think, that hopefully will be helpful to other people as well. So this is pretty much just a huge meeting, so it's always good to have an agenda, right? So, okay, we're going to talk a little bit about why we decided to embark on this Kubernetes mission. We're going to talk a little bit about how we did it. I'm going to have a few pro tips littered throughout, and also some of my cats, and cats from the neighborhood, because I feel like people could use cats today. Anyhow, so why? Well, clearly, because it's 100% certain to solve all of our infrastructure problems, it's going to be a silver bullet, a panacea, it will make the world a better place, et cetera. No, of course not. But if you disagree with me, I will replace your DevOps with a small Kubernetes cluster. And also, I save 15% by switching to Kubernetes. Okay. So let me just tell you a little bit about what Olark is first, so we have a basis to go on. Basically, we're a live chat provider, software as a service live chat provider. You copy a little bit of code onto your website, and then you log into our like admin chat panel, and you can talk to visitors that show up on your website. And legacy is not, like, we're not this. Like, we're a startup in 2009 YC, so, you know, if you were expecting, like, how to move your VAX thing to Kubernetes, that's not going to happen. And honestly, our architecture fits Kubernetes' idea of the universe relatively well already. Like, our previous architecture, we're got some microservices and all those fun things. We have dozens of them. Some of them might be a little more macro than micro. They're mostly in Python, but there's some Ruby, Node, and Erlang here and there. Most of them are stateless. We use Rabbit and Thrift really heavily in our infrastructure. And most of our state is in MySQL, with some in Redis and Memcache and other various things here and there. And there aren't a huge number of single points of failure that we have. And we currently have hundreds of single-purpose VMs at Rackspace. By single-purpose, I mean it's the VM that runs one process, basically. Yeah, it doesn't, you know, there's no, we don't really have things that are like trying to manage utilization or anything. It's all managed with Puppet. And we have a few pets that, like, if something bad happens to them, these guys over here are going to get paged and then run out of the room. So it's not perfect, but it's sort of close to what Kubernetes might expect from services. But we have really, really bad utilization right now. I mean, this is like, you know, we have this one server that's using maybe a quarter of a CPU most of the time. And maybe it's using a little more memory. It's just an example I pulled out of Munin. But thinking about trying to manually allocate processes here and there to like put a CPU-intensive process and a memory-intensive process on the same machine is just like, that's like that would keep me up at night. So we're burning like kind of a lot of money with bad utilization. We're also tired of babysitting these individual machines if one of them gets whacked in the middle of the night and pages someone. There's still some manual intervention we have to do. And we want better velocity. Right now, scaling takes us on the order of hours to spin up new infrastructure if we are expecting more customers or a higher traffic period of the year and stuff, which is sort of a waste of time that we would like to avoid. So, as I said before, we're reasonably well suited to Kubernetes. But our first attempt was a little bit of the red pill, I guess. I said we're relatively well-suited, but we ran into some problems trying to get our Redis, production Redis cluster running in Kubernetes. In the end, we just decided to run it on bare metal because it was just not, it wasn't worth the fight right now. I feel like probably by the early next year, someone's gonna have a nice little Helm chart that we're just gonna be able to install, and then it'll solve all of our problems anyway. So I'm just like, whoever, someone in the audience, make our Redis work. But in the meantime, basically we had, because we needed to use Redis Sentinel, and pet sets are pretty new, and we were trying to figure out how to get that all working correctly. It turned out to be more effort than it was worth at this time for us to try to migrate stuff off. So maybe later. So that brings me to my first tip. Let's go with the flow. Sometimes it's not necessarily worth trying to get your application or a third-party application like all worked out in order to get onto Kubernetes. It might be a better idea to just like not drink the buzzword Kool-Aid and decide that you can run it the old-fashioned way for a little while. Most of the time we can choose the blue pill, because I said before, we think we're pretty well suited to Kubernetes already. So if you also can choose the blue pill and you've decided to Kubernetes, let's talk a little bit about how you would have to go about that. The first thing that is sort of maybe obvious to everyone here is that you have to containerize things. It turns out it's really easy to containerize cats. You just put a container and then they go in it. It's not quite that easy for other things, but that's sort of like a different talk and a different problem. So I'm not gonna talk about that anymore. And actually for us, our step negative one was to apply a little bit of 12-factor. I don't know if everyone has seen this, but take a look at 12-factor.net. It's sort of principles for building microservice applications that apply pretty well to Kubernetes stuff too. And it made us, it made it easier for us to move our stuff to Kubernetes once we had like environment variables configuring our applications and logs logging the standard out and stuff like that that Kubernetes expects. So we did all that stuff. And then our first attempt was to sort of, or our first idea was to try to put a full dev environment in Kubernetes with like everything running there. And then like, oh, maybe one day it'll be good enough and we can just cut it over to production. We sort of figured out that that was a bad idea pretty quickly, sort of because of the long tail issue. This is the closest photo of that I could get to this graph, where we have a lot of services, and moving the first few is going to get us a lot of benefit, but sort of further down the way, there's a lot less less return on your investment. So for us to move our entire infrastructure over and then like cut a switch was not really realistic. And this sort of brings me to summarize. If you can't throw the switch until all of your infrastructure is migrated, you may never finish. And if you do, your stuff probably will break. And like may and probably are not probably true. Like almost certainly, if you just like spend a whole bunch of time death marching until you have something and then cut over, it's probably just blow up. So don't do that. You can get a lot of value just by like taking the first part of the, I guess that's like the cat butt part of it before it gets to the tail, but and we're sort of like still here in this process. So as I said, still a work in progress. I don't know if we'll end up getting all the way down there. We may end up deciding that you know, some of our legacy stuff will stay legacy, but we'll see. So that brings me to another tip. Beware of the big migrate, which I think is a cousin of the big rewrite. If you feel like you're going down this path, step back, think about whether you that's really the right strategy for your infrastructure migration. So we came up with a strategy to avoid this. And the first thing was to move a less important ancillary service, something we could work the kinks out on, and to answer as many sort of unknown unknowns that we could. And then to move like kind of the most risky service, because if we do the hardest thing and it works, then everything else is easier. And it reduces the risk of like, all right, we saved the most risky thing for the end, and then we moved it, and it didn't work, and so we can't do this, and all of that effort was wasted.
How do you classify those? How do you determine which one is the most risky service for
the end? I might answer your question in the next couple slides. If not, I will answer it later. So once the most risky service is migrated, we're going to move the rest of our core infrastructure sort of outside in. This sort of prevents a lot of trips in and out of the Kubernetes cluster. But we think we need to do this somewhat quickly because we're sort of in this intermediate state where there's like maybe additional failure modes as a result of us being in two separate places with our networking going across a VPN. And then this is when we start working on the long tail. Once that core stuff is done, move some stuff that's less likely to be disruptive in case of failure. And honestly, there are some things that have been around for a long time and barely do anything anymore, and we could probably just kill them instead of migrating them. And so the sort of like nugget I took out of this was to try to change as few variables at a time as is reasonably possible so that you can sort of like make sure you're progressing in the right direction as you move. And you might need to do extra work, but just like having good tests and stuff like that is probably worth it in the end because you're more likely to succeed. And a little secret. It's not really specific to Kubernetes. I think like any sort of migration or a sort of large undertaking is best done in a piecewise fashion that you can check as you're going along. So we were looking around for our less important service that didn't really matter that much. So naturally chose our billing system. Not as crazy as it sounds. It happens to be low bandwidth, unfortunately. I mean, you know, it's like a handful of requests per second or something. It's like, I mean, I wish it was like we had like serious scaling issues with our billing system, but unfortunately not. It also happens to be representative of the rest of our infrastructure because it uses the same databases. It uses Thrift, which we use heavily elsewhere. It uses Rabbit. That's what a rabbit might look like. These are things that we use all throughout our infrastructure. So getting those running in production on Kubernetes is like valuable in and of themselves because a lot of other things depend on them. It's also relatively easy to roll out and roll back. There's not really a lot of consequences for us to like cutting back to the old one if it didn't work. And it's actually really quite low risk because Stripe is still going to charge you even if our billing system, like it's just, someone might not be able to sign up or upgrade a plan if it's down, but all of our existing customers and all of our revenue is still being processed by Stripe. So, yeah. And so it went pretty smoothly. It definitely forced us to work out some kinks in how we were setting up our Kubernetes, getting our VPN working between Kubernetes and our old infrastructure, database connectivity, and like how we were gonna revision control our infrastructure going forward. So then we move on to the most risky service. And you, if you have a cat, you know why that's risky. First, a little bit of warning. I did these graphics, so they are not awesome. So this is our most risky thing. It's our it's what serves our chat traffic from the visitor side. It's 40% of our infrastructure just for this one application, from like a dollar or a traffic standpoint or whatever. Like it's pushing a couple gigabits a second back and forth between the rest of our infrastructure. And if it goes down, then our chat doesn't work at all. So, you know, it's not super, it's not like the payment thing where things will still like mostly work if it's gone. So, but it's still pretty, it's pretty well suited to Kubernetes because there's just stateless services that are running. Any user can hit any backend and get their chats routed properly. It uses Redis for storing its state, which that's why we were trying to like get Redis working in Kubernetes. But as I said, we ended up deciding to just run that the old-fashioned way. And this is actually still a work in progress. We are, I don't know, maybe we have it running in dev. We're maybe going to try running this in production for some customers over the next couple weeks. But we did learn some valuable lessons from this already. One of them is that trying to switch monitoring and hosting at the same time, or really monitoring and any sort of change at the same time, is a recipe for disaster. So the tip is to perform baseline measurements of your system that you're moving so that you know if you've broken something after you move it. as part of this, we're trying to deprecate our old monitoring stuff that was sort of like home-rolled. And so we don't really want to, but we can't like have just the new monitoring and the new Kubernetes cluster and the old monitoring and the old Kubernetes cluster because the numbers aren't really like comparable to each other. So what we decided to do to help us with this is to use Linkerd. And if you haven't heard of Linkerd, it's like a little service mesh layer 7 RPC load balancer. And it has really good Kubernetes support. It gathers a bunch of performance metrics just for free when you use it. And so we decided to use this both in Kubernetes in our, and in our legacy infrastructure so that as we migrate, we can like make sure all of those numbers are staying in the green. And I know that at least one person from Buoyant is here. So if you are interested in talking to someone about Linkerd, William's around here somewhere. So it gives us these kind of metrics. You can't read that at all, but there's like 99th percentile, 95th percentile, 50th percentile, max latencies, requests per second, failure rate, stuff like that. And it's all, it exposes Prometheus endpoints as well as stuff for other monitoring things. So it's easy to aggregate these from like all of your Linkerd instances or whatever into whatever you're using so that you can monitor it. And the way we're using this is that we have, so like in our legacy data center, we have two Linkerds running there, and then we have Linkerds as a daemon set per node inside of Kubernetes. And within each like data center or zone or whatever, they're talking to their local Linkerd, and then their local Linkerd knows how to route that request to the right place. So as we move, like if we move service 3 over to Kubernetes, we're just going to update some config in the various Linkerds to point it to the new one in Kubernetes instead of back at the old one. And so instead of having to like push a configuration change to your actual application to point it at a different thing, it's sort of like a load balancer, right? You can just like cut over the load balancer to the new one, and rolling back is really easy to cut over back. Plus, you get all those fun metrics. So definitely, even if you're not like migrating anything, I think Linkerd is worth a look if you want to, if you have like, you know, service-oriented architecture kind of stuff and you need or want better metrics without having to instrument the applications yourself, because you get that for free. It also does retries and some other cool things. So, yeah. So another thing we learned is that Kubernetes networking is weird, just like him, because he sits in sinks like that for some reason. But you can't just VPN in and out like a normal data center because of all the stuff that kubeproxy does and the sort of IPs that aren't really meaningful outside of the cluster. And so we sort of went through a variety of different ways of trying to make our legacy stuff be able to talk to Kubernetes services and our Kubernetes stuff be able to talk back to our legacy stuff. And what we sort of ended up on is is doing some hackery with services so that they're pointing to various places that might not necessarily be within Kubernetes, but you still get all the service discovery and stuff that services give you, and also to use Linkerd, so that we can always just basically talk to Linkerd all the time. But because we have, in our old Puppet stuff, we have a list of where all the services are pointed anyways in our legacy infrastructure, we can use that to generate services and endpoints that allow Kubernetes to communicate back with our regular infrastructure. Yep.
Do you mean to say the backend was actually outside the cluster for the service?
Sorry?
You kept the backend outside the cluster. Is that what you meant here?
I kept the back. So in some cases, our services in Kubernetes are talking back to services that are running in our old infrastructure outside of Kubernetes. So the services are just like, we're just using them as pointers, or like, I mean, it's like DNS kind of, except like fancier. like we can use it as service discovery. When we switch it, the service name stays the same. Everything's connecting the same thing. It's just in Kubernetes now instead of there. External name is like one thing that you can use to kind of do this too. We constructed our own endpoints like this. And this like resolve thing gets processed through a make file to resolve like our internal DNS, not actually from DNS, but from the stuff that actually produces our DNS records to begin with. So that just like it creates all these endpoints for some service. Manually, and then our stuff can talk to that. And so this has come in really handy. It allows us to define all our services in Kubernetes as we would if they were actually running in Kubernetes, even though they are not. So yeah, that worked. Risky thing. It didn't bite me. But I said that we had infrastructure that was relatively well suited to Kubernetes. It turns out on the other side of our, on the operator side instead of the visitors to the website, the operators, this is not so well suited because these things are stateful, and this load balancer has to be sticky. Because this is an XFPP connection between our backends to our Jabber server. When Olark started, it was we didn't have our own client. We just had people use their own XMPP client to connect to our service, so like Pigeon or Adium or whatever. And then we built our own XMPP client, web-based XMPP client, later. But because XMPP requires a persistent TCP connection and all of that, we still need to have some persistence between visitor requests and the backend that their XMPP connection is connected to. And we could fix this, but that's a much larger undertaking, we think, than getting this to all just sort of maybe not do exactly what Kubernetes wants it to do, but at least for the time being, we'll serve our purposes. So we ended up hacking service load balancer and some termination grace periods on pods to get like kind of what we wanted to do. And we're not going to actually set it to a day, but like if this pod sticks around for a while, people will eventually like sign off from that thing and will not just sort of, you know, after a day or something, there'll be like six people still attached to it or something, and like they can just be reconnected. So sort of what we figured out here is that you can gain a lot of flexibility by deploying some custom pods or like hacking some things that are internal to Kubernetes. Service load balancer isn't actually internal to Kubernetes, but it's a contrib package, and we just made some minor modifications to do this. It works pretty well. My recommendation is just to pick your battles wisely. In this case, unlike the Redis case, we didn't really have another good option for, we definitely didn't want to just run this the old-fashioned way, because we're not going to be able to get any like auto-scaling benefit, and deploying additional ones of these is relatively common, and so we don't want to, you know, leave all that behind just for a little bit of fight. So that's pretty much what I have here. The takeaways I think here are, control your change, try not to do too much at one time, go with the flow when you can, have some baseline measurements. Occasionally you might need to do something a little crazy, like a little stateful thing. And I like to put cats in my slides. Thank you. All right. I think I have a couple minutes, maybe. Do I have a couple minutes? Oh, wait, hang on. I have to do this. I was told to do this several times.
Hi, this is John Tesh. I wanted to ask about that service load balancer you just mentioned.
Uh-huh.
A little more elaboration on that.
Oh, sure. So service load balancer is like a, I don't know, example thing in the Kubernetes contrib repo that is just HA proxy that is Kubernetes aware. So you can use it for internal load balancing of your services and stuff like that. And you can use it for external ingress if you want. It's not an ingress controller, but like you can use it to like route traffic from outside into your cluster. Ah. And it has sticky session support built into it.
Where is information on this?
If you just Google service-load balancer Kubernetes, you'll definitely find it. It's in the main Kubernetes repo somewhere.
Excellent.
Anyone else?
You said networking was especially tricky. Did you try multiple network overlays or stick with one the whole time?
What do you mean by multiple network overlays?
Like flannel versus calico versus?
We didn't really do any of that. We're using GKE for our stuff, and I don't even know if you can like do that inside of there. But we were just trying to. So we have a VPN from Rackspace to like GCE using their like software as a service load balancers on both ends. But that just gives you access to the node IPs on the Kubernetes side, right? So like you still need to like get into the cluster somehow. And then going the other way around, it's like if you are running your own Kubernetes cluster, you can add to kubeDNS, you can add a configuration for an upstream DNS provider that you would use your internal DNS or something like that for that, right? But since we were using GKE, if you modify that pod and then upgrade your cluster, it will smash it. And we didn't want the risk of that inadvertently happening at a bad time and like all of our Kubernetes stuff not knowing about our old stuff anymore. So that's sort of how that all worked out. I think someone behind you, do you want to pass that?
So I know Kubernetes services has external IPs. You mentioned something like external name. Is that synonymous or is that something different?
I think it's something different.
Okay.
We didn't end up using those, and instead, my web browser's all closed and stuff. I think if you Google it, there's like you can in a service you can give it a DNS name, right? But because we didn't have our DNS working, that wouldn't like our private DNS is not available inside of our Kubernetes cluster. That wasn't really an option for us. But if you have like public DNS or if you have DNS accessible, you can use external name in the service to just point at some random DNS somewhere as like the service.
Got it. Thanks.
Yeah. Anyone else? Okay. Cool. Thank you.